Hey, good evening, Top Fans. Bill, again here from Top Fan Rivalry. I am here with my good buddy Jackson Westfall tonight. Little short on the clubhouse, but you know what? It's like 90 degrees in California right now, and we're trying to figure it all out, right? So, Jackson, thanks for joining us tonight.
Yeah.
We got so much to talk about in the world of baseball over the last week. Where to start? Jackson, you were mentioning off camera, minor leagues. You want to start there?
Yeah. I mean, MLB was talking about their promotion schedule. And, you know, it reminds you that the minor league season is going to start, which is exciting. We missed out on it last year. So there's a lot of articles circulating around about top prospects and where guys are going to play. You know, it's exciting for the young guys. And I think it's exciting for the people that live in those cities that don't get to watch as much baseball, like living in Utah right now. Salt Lake has a team, Ogden has a team, Orem all have minor league affiliates. So it'll be fun to be able to actually go to the ballpark and enjoy, a semi-pro game at least.
Yeah. And those are fun too, because those are the fellas that are trying to make the team, not the guys that are getting paid, seven figures to strike out, right? That's good times.
Yeah, and the stadium food's a lot more affordable.
Yeah. So that's awesome. Now you were telling me something about Jackie Robinson. Why don't we talk about that for a second?
So the Dayton Tortugas, the minor league affiliate of the Reds, is doing a promotion for their version of Jackie Robinson Day. They're going to be giving out a jersey that's kind of a replica of the one that Jackie Robinson wore in spring training in 1946, which I think is really cool with the number 9. So it's a fun little history tidbit, for us really big baseball nerds, knowing that Jackie Robinson wore a different number a long time ago, once upon a time.
Yeah, and it was in Cincinnati where the alleged incident with Pee Wee Reese happened.
Yeah, so, right. I mean, I think it's a cool tidbit of history, and that's what minor league baseball is for. It's to just have people love the game and learn something new about the game every time you go to the ballpark.
Absolutely. Okay, so we got to go around the horn now and talk about injuries.
Oof.
Okay, I'll go last because this one hurts. But did you hear what happened in the Central today?
Yeah, Eloy. No. But Luis Robert is rupturing his pectoral muscle. But the Sox possibly lost Luis Robert for the remainder of the season with a grade 3 strain of the hip flexor, which is a complete tear. That's like a 16-week injury, they say, without baseball. So that's going to impact the White Sox a lot. He's another one of their spark plugs, good young players. It just sucks to see him go down. The Braves suffered more injuries this week, even though they got Sean Newcomb come back. Travis d'Arnaud is probably out on the 60-day IL with a thumb injury after a collision at the plate in the Saturday night's game. And then his backup, Alex Jackson, pulled his hamstring like 2 innings later.
Yep. So you always want your backup catcher.
Right. Yep. So they had to call up the young prospect, William Contreras, brother of Wilson Contreras. Jeff Mathis is back up in the major leagues as the backup for Atlanta. So, injuries, it's all hands on deck,
Yep. All hands on deck.
I think Corbin Burns also went down this week with an undisclosed injury. So it just sucks to see so many players go down, and it's impacting the standings early on. You can see that teams like the Braves and the Brewers, the Padres, the Dodgers, are all struggling with injuries, and it really reflects on their record. They can't really get rolling.
Yeah, it's been tough.
Dodgers.
You just mentioned the Dodgers. I was watching the game yesterday. Dustin May, or 2 days ago, Dustin May looks awesome, right, for the first couple of innings. And in inning 3, he throws this pitch, and if you haven't seen it, immediately he does that little spin around that he does. He's like that, and immediately you see him go to the dugout and go like this, come out, and Trevor Bauer and Clayton Kershaw and who was the other one? I think it was Walker Buehler are all sitting in the dugout and they're trying to explain to Dave Roberts what happened. And they're pointing, you know, to this part of the arm elbow area, which, you know, is terrible. And so they announced today that he needs to have Tommy John surgery. So he'll be out the remainder of this season. And usually Tommy John is about a 16-month recovery time. So if he comes back, it'll be in September of 2022. And so he won't be competitive. He'll pitch a couple of games and then really try to make his mark in 2023. So, which is terrible because he was just starting to become that spark plug. So, and I watched the injury to Robert today. Oh my gosh, this guy, it looked bad. It looked bad. As soon as he hit that base, you could tell he was in pain. And so it's just, baseball's a weird game like that. Everybody says that football and hockey are dangerous. Well, play 162 games and you tell me how you feel, right?
Yeah, not a lot of guys play every game anymore. You know, back in the day, everyone played every game. But nowadays, guys take regular days off. It's physically demanding.
It is. It's very physically demanding. So let's talk a little bit about stats. I mean, there's a lot of stuff going on in the MLB, right? First of all, Mike Trout's killing the ball, right, at 413. JD Martinez is just destroying the ball in RBIs-wise, right? Anytime there's anybody on base, he's knocking them in. But you're our statistician, Jackson. You are the Top Fan Rivalry statistician. We were talking about a couple of things, but tell me about batting averages. Aren't those down this season?
They are. MLB will probably blame the balls that they're putting in humidifiers, you know, or they'll try and blame the pitchers and lower the mound again, whatever, you know, because they don't like pitcher stools, even though we all do.
We all do.
You know, a nice fast game. You know, they want to speed the game up, yet they punish the pitcher, which is really ironic. But, you know, I think good pitching should be rewarded. Max Scherzer yesterday threw a complete game, then went to the hospital and watched his child be born, you know? So I just think that the philosophy of baseball right now with teams just, you know, not valuing the single, not valuing, you know, the moving over the runner or productive outs where your yes. out isn't productive unless you drive the runner in. And, yes. you know, we sound like a broken record on this show, just talking about how asinine it is sometimes that guys just go up and swing for the fence every single at bat. But so as a whole, a lot of hitters are trending downwards in terms of batting average, slugging percentage, on base percentage. A lot of free swingers in the league, but it's really kind of nice now, though. You can see the players that adjust and take the next step. I will throw Acuna up there because he's having a monster start to the year. He's become a lot more patient. He's cut his strikeout percentage almost in half and almost doubled his walk percentage, and that's why he's thriving, you know? And I'm going to throw a bone. I'm going to sound like a Braves homer here, though. But Austin Riley leads all third basemen in the MLB and on-base percentage. And this is a guy that last year struck out about 40% of the time at the plate. It's the change of philosophy. And I think the teams that adapt, the teams that do it really well, the Dodgers are really good at stringing hits together. The Padres are really good at stringing the hits together. Teams that can consistently string hits and walks together are the ones that will – go far in the playoffs because you just can't swing for the fences. The Rangers showed us that about a decade ago. You can't do that. Baltimore showed us that the latter half of last decade. The Twins in the last couple of years, you know, they lead the league in home runs every year, but they get to the playoffs and they can't hit. I just think the changing in the analytics of baseball, I mean, it helps you win regular season games. It helps you bounce the 4 or 5 pitcher in the rotation, but it's all about the pitching and it's all about overcoming that pitching.
And it's really, it's funny that you say that too.
So many dominant pitchers this early in the year.
Well, we've seen 2 no hitters so far this season already. And we're not even 10 days into May yet. And you see a lot of guys that you thought would start out hot that are ice cold and guys that you thought out might start out okay or starting out hot. And then you see guys that, like you said, you didn't anticipate, you know, the Braves third baseman to be just doing what he's doing. I didn't expect Justin Turner to have the start that he's having. I mean, Justin Turner's not having a bad start to the season. And I mean, it seems like it's a pitcher's game. Now tell me, did you see what happened yesterday? I think it was in Cincinnati. Yesterday or the day before in Cincinnati with Omar Garrett and Javi Baez.
So Amir Garrett obviously has a history. He started that brawl with the Pirates a couple of years ago, sprinting towards the dugout. there was another incident with the strikeout this week too, funnily enough. But, you know, just I think pitchers get so upset when hitters celebrate on them, but then they tend to over-celebrate on the hitters a lot. And hitters really take exception to that. And we saw that again with Jose Alvarado in the Phillies-Mets game the other day too, where he strikes out a batter. And, you know, as he's walking to the dugout, he's screaming stuff at him. It's like, you know, you can celebrate it, but you don't need to provoke him. And it's that really it shows the change in the culture of the game. Guys aren't afraid of getting thrown at anymore. Guys aren't afraid of, you know, starting beef with other people. Whereas back in the day, you started beef with someone, it was going to end in a benches clearing brawl. And it's not like the brawls nowadays where they push and shove. It, like, fists were going to be thrown and guys were going to get suspended one, maybe two games for just beating the crap out of each other.
Well, it's legit. I mean, these guys, it's funny because they always say offense sells tickets, defense wins games, right? And a pitcher can show emotion like Gratterall showed in the playoffs, or with checking his glove, or Garrett showed by striking out. Although I thought Garrett's emotion was a little over the top on this one. I mean, they were losing. It wasn't like he came in, you know, and his bases loaded and they're up by one run and he strikes out somebody. He struck out Anthony Rizzo when they were losing the game already. I mean, it wasn't, but he and Rizzo have beef anyway, right? So I think it's equally as important for pitchers to be able to show emotion as it is for hitters to be able to show emotion. But I think, like Trevor Bauer said, it's also Bush League for pitchers to react to that emotion. So if I walk off the mound swinging my arms like Trevor Bauer does, right, and some guy hits a home run off me and he touches home and he swings his arms like I do, okay, good, whatever, we're having fun, right? Back in the old days, you did that and the pitcher throws it. You do that to Nolan Ryan, duck. I mean, this guy's going to throw something at you, right? Roger Clemens, you know, and so not if those boys are listening to this, you fellas were great players. I'm sorry, but we're going to drop some names here. My bad. It's amazing what we're seeing. Going back to JT's stats for a second, he's got 21 RBIs and 6 home runs, and he's hitting .337 to start the season. That's not bad.
That's good.
That's not great. Bad at all. For a 36-year-old guy that we barely
saw. I don't think the Dodgers were expecting that kind of production, you know, but it's helped them because most of their lineup's been pretty bad. You know, they haven't looked like the Dodgers. Mookie Betts not having a great year. I think he has 5 home runs, but only, 6 RBIs, something like that?
Yeah. And he had 3 home runs going into this weekend, or 3 RBIs going into this weekend with 2 home runs. And he and 3 of those, or 2 of those 3 RBIs were solo home runs. Good for you, Mookie. Good for you.
Yeah.
So I'm excited that we're starting to get into the dog days of summer a little bit. You know, you got May coming up, but I'm anxious to see how certain things play out. I'm still not as happy as I could have been with the umpiring situation. That's terrible, right? That is absolutely awful lately. And we won't mention any names here, but we had Angel Hernandez for the last 2 series, and if I don't ever see him again in another series this season, but we've got the umpiring situation. We've had some early brawls, right, from teams that you wouldn't expect to brawl. So a lot to look forward to. And there's still a lot of baseball to play, right? I mean, even with all these injuries, there's still a lot of baseball to be played. And so, and if you look at the standings, they're not exactly like what we had thought or we had predicted, are they?
No.
Yeah, I'm trying to pull this stuff up right now, but I would have not thought the Giants would have started out as good as they did. I didn't expect Milwaukee to be as good as they are. I definitely didn't expect Washington to be in first place starting May. I figured you guys over at the Braves would be in first place and be running away with it. If you would have told me that you'd be four games under 500, you know, on May 3rd, I would have laughed and said, there's no way, not with that lineup.
Yeah.
But that's why we play 162, right?
Yep.
So
if baseball was won on paper, it'd be Dodgers Yankees every year, wouldn't it?
Hey, I'm okay with that.
Dodgers Red Sox.
Dodgers. Yeah, I mean Kansas City 16-10.
Kansas City's looked good this year.
They have.
They're looking like the Kansas City of old, clutch hitting, good pitching. You know, that's what wins games.
And neither one of us, because we thought it was a rebuilding year for the Red Sox, neither one of us would have said, hey, three games into May and the Red Sox would be 17-12 and be in first place.
So, yeah.
I mean, with a run differential of point, you know, of plus 20.
Yeah.
So the poor Tigers, man, they're 8-21 with a run differential of negative 62.
Yeah. Detroit has not looked good this year. They're about where we expected them to be. Baltimore's been better than Detroit, so has Pittsburgh.
That's a bit
of a surprise that Pittsburgh's been better than Detroit, but, you know, there's a lot of baseball left to play. It's all about maintaining your record. And
yeah.
You know, you'll see it. You'll see teams sit at 48-60, and you're like, wow, they have a shot of finishing close to 500, and they'll finish, like, 59, 103. It just takes a couple really bad weeks to kind of just throw you off track. But luckily, early on, I mean, you would like to win all your games. Like, we'd hope to be at least at 500, you know, four games up in the win column. But, you know, we just got to find the pitching, the consistent pitching, the consistent hitting. Got to get a hit in extra innings because they still haven't done that. I think they're 0-4 in extra innings this year, which is mind-boggling, maddening almost.
Yeah, if you would have told me that 25 games in the season that the Pirates would have a better record than the Cubs, I knew the Cubs weren't going to be that good, but I didn't realize they were going to be that bad.
The surprising thing about the Cubs is all their pitchers that are supposed to be bad are actually pitching pretty well. All their pitchers that are supposed to be good are pitching really bad. It's been one of those years where we had a weird year last year, so it's definitely affecting the product on the field of some teams. And I think that's why we're seeing a lot of cold hitters. Like, they got a full spring training. And I think just like the expectation to play a full season, they're trying to press and get off to the super hot start through an 162 game season after playing 60 last year. And it's not going so well.
Yeah, no, it's not. And for you Southern California fans that are watching this, you Angel fans, and I'm going to turn this over to Jackson and ask, and he didn't know I'm going to ask him this, but how concerned are you if you're an Angel fan that you're 500, you're 13-13, but your run differential is negative 16?
So run differential in baseball is a weird thing. I'll go use a World Series example for you. When the Pirates played the Yankees in the World Series in 1960, the Yankees crushed the Pirates in run differential, but the Pirates won four games. So if you're an Angels fan, you got to feel pretty good that you're off to a 500 start and, you know, your pitching's been an absolute mess, that you're being carried by Jared Walsh, who's fantastic in the second half of last year. They're playing him a lot more in the outfield and a lot more at first base. which what they should do. And it's giving Mike Trout some protection, and Shohei Ohtani's going off as well, because the lineup is so deep, they have to pitch to all these guys now. So as an Angels fan, you got to feel good because that offense is sustainable, because Rendon's been hurt. He hasn't been consistently hitting when he is in the lineup. So as long as the lineup just keeps chugging along, if they can get like a 4.5, like a 4 ERA from their starting pitching, they'll be fine.
Yeah.
Their pitching just has to keep them in the game. That offense can do some damage.
And I'm looking at their schedule. They've got the Rays at home for 4, and then the Dodgers at home for 3.
Well, that'll be a fun series.
Yeah, and then they go on the road with Houston for 3, and then they go to Boston for 3. And so, yeah, they have 2 off days all month. And then they go on this stretch when they go with Boston. 3 in Boston, 3 with Cleveland at home, a doubleheader at home with the Twins, which are makeup games. So the Twins are flying in for this doubleheader on their off day. And then 3 with Oakland. So you have a span of, what is that, 2, 8, so that's 10, 11 games in a row. Most of them at home. I mean, 3 in Boston, but most of them at home. So, but you have some decent teams there, right? Oakland's playing well. Boston's playing great. And Houston's teetering. And let's not forget that they meet the Dodgers this weekend, and they're going to lose 3 in Anaheim against the Dodgers.
I mean, I wouldn't be so sure looking at the Dodgers' anemic offense before Sunday.
Anemic offense. It's a good thing that we're on this, like, Zoom. Ooh, anemic offense. We're not talking about the Tigers here. We have anemic offense. And tell you what, Atlanta's got anemic offense.
They do.
All right, Jackson, 30 seconds. Tell me.
They do. Everybody can hit consistently.
There you go. 30, 45 seconds. Tell me what you're looking for this week as a Braves fan, what you're looking for maybe in baseball, but predominantly as a Braves fan.
Well, I do have a side note about minor league / independent league baseball, something that I forgot that I read on Saturday. I read an article that the Pioneer League in the independent leagues, instead of playing extra innings, is now considering doing a home run derby, a 5-swing home run derby to decide games. Which I think it'd be exciting, but I also think it would be very, very luck-based. You just pick a hitter and get 5 swings.
Yeah.
You know, so support your local independent league team, support your local minor league team. They're just trying to have fun out there. Notes for the Braves. I mean, this is a big week for them. You know, they just got swept by Toronto. They're traveling to DC. They got to play Washington for 3. So they're not facing Max Scherzer, which I think is really good for them because he usually pitches really well against the Braves. They got 3 against Washington, 3 against the Phillies, and they play Toronto and Milwaukee, which will be 2 tough series. But, you know, they just got to play a couple games above 500. They're still in this division. If they can beat up on the Nationals, they can beat up on the Phillies. After the Toronto-Milwaukee series, you know, you get the Mets, who are doing very Mets things this season. You get 4 against the Pirates to get back on track, you know?
Doing very Mets things.
Well, yeah. Jacob DeGrom's given up 2 runs all season. He has 2 losses. That's...
I know. And he takes like a champ. He's not going to mention any names here, but he's not John Lackey, right? He takes it like a champ. I mean, he's not beat up on his team, right? I mean, come on. This is awesome.
I think he tried to call him out after like the first 10 times it happened in the locker room. And then he's just given up at this point. He's just like, you know what, guys? Sorry, I couldn't throw a perfect game today. It's my bad. His attitude now.
I gave up 1 run. My bad, fellas.
My bad.
Oh man. Well, the Dodgers have now 3 in 2 days with Chicago since they got rained out tonight. So 3 in Chicago. Then here we go. This is where it gets goofy. We fly home, but actually to play Anaheim, right? And for those of you that are on watching this, if you're not familiar with Southern California, doorstep to doorstep, Dodgers to Angel Stadium is less than 40 miles. And so it's, I want to say it's maybe 25 miles. It's like right around the corner. So we fly home. We have an off day, the 6th. We play 3 with the Angels. Then we have an off day, a travel day, to drive from Anaheim to LA. Just get this on record. Where then we play the Mariners for two games, just two. Then we have another off day, where then we go and we play another 3-7 at home. So we have a 9-game homestand with two off days in between. Just get that on record. So if we're not rested by the end of this month, then there's something doggone wrong, because we have 1, 2, 3, 4 off days this month. Yep. So I'm concerned about the Dodgers bats, although Mookie in his post-game interview on Saturday after they gave up the 5-3 lead and gave up the win, Mookie straight out said, we can't let the, in paraphrasing, he was straight out saying, we can't continue to think it's early because anything can happen. And he's right. I mean, not too many years ago when the wild card system came into play and you only had one wild card team, and I should have had you look this up for me beforehand, Jackson, but it'd take too much time to look up now. Maybe we'll kind of come back to it next week. But the Cincinnati Reds missed the playoffs. I think they had 92 wins or 90 wins that season, and they missed the playoffs. Now, if you got 90 wins, you should probably be a shoo-in for the playoffs. Just going to put that out there right there. But, you know, so yeah. Am I concerned about the offense? They went off yesterday in Milwaukee. So that made me happy. Props to Dustin May. Hat tip to you, my friend. And, you know, speedy recovery. I know your surgery is on Tuesday, but a speedy recovery to you. And let's hope to see you in Dodger Blue here sometime soon. Dodgers, just keep playing like you did the first part of the season. So that's what I got from you from a Dodger perspective. Now, things... You're looking up that stat, aren't you? The Reds, aren't you?
I am.
Now you're curious.
Now I am curious. Yeah, I can't find it.
Yeah, we'll have to look it up for next.
I'll have to dig deep.
Top fans, a couple of things that you need to know. I'm gonna call Jackson out right now. Jackson is our top Braves fan, and he's putting together an article for you on the first 25 for the Braves. If you don't see it on topfanrivalry.com in the next week and a half, by all means, send us an email and say, what happened to Jackson, right? Where's Jackson? Maybe I'll get some shirts printed up that say, where's Jackson?
Hopefully not crushed underneath the forklift at work. That would
be- There you go. But a couple things to look forward to, top fans. You should see not only this up, but you should see a interview that I did with a father and a daughter that are Red Sox fans. And we've got some stuff for the Before the Bigs coming up. And we have a little bit of a surprise. We're getting ready to launch something, so it should be a lot of fun. But to be continued. So, top fans, make sure you subscribe below. Make sure that you go to the site and subscribe as well. You get a bunch of fun information and things like that coming. So, Jackson, thank you for your time tonight. Appreciate you. You're always welcome in the clubhouse. And let's go Dodgers, right?
Let's go Braves. And anyone but the Braves. Phillies and Mets, I guess.
There you go.
At this point.
Thanks, Jackson, for your time.
Yeah.